city of Kolkata, 200 years ago, the then capital of British India. A city of rich heritage, of culture, citadel of political power. A city also agog to become a prime business center. But the financial market was unorganized, ruthless. Shroffs and Mahajans dominating the market. Interest rate on loans as high as 60%. European merchants were unable to use this market and took the initiative to form banks on European models to support the government and finance the East India Company in its business and war efforts. Years ago, in 1806, a path-breaking institution was born, the Bank of Calcutta. The bank was renamed as Bank of Bengal, the first joint-stock bank in British India. Thus began India's long march towards modern banking. Slowly but distinctly, India was ushering itself into a formal banking system. Elites of society soon took notice of the emerging giant. Prince Dwarkanath Tagore, grandfather of Rabindranath Tagore, and Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar were among the customers of the bank. Having tasted success in Bengal, banking institutions started coming up in other parts of the country as well. Bank of Bombay was established on 15th April 1840, and 3 years later, Bank of Madras was opened on 1st July 1843. These three presidency banks started issuing bank notes ranging from sikka rupees 10 to rupees 10,000, which for the first time were legal tender for making public revenue payments. Departing sharply from unguided, arbitrary, and unwritten rules of indigenous practices of money lenders, these three banks started defining banking business. The rules of business were clearly spelled out for customers. Today's charter for customers owes its origin to these banks. Slowly but distinctly, holding the hands of these banks, India was ushering itself into a formal banking system. Respectful compliance of rules has been the hallmark of the bank, although so much so that the bank returned a check issued by Governor General William Bentinck as the balance in his account fell short by 4 annas only. The Governor General appreciated the decision and remarked, "This was the bank to do business with, which would not violate its rules in the smallest particular for the Governor General himself." Time rolled on. By about the 1860s, expansion of the railway tracks and telegraph, opening of the Suez Canal, completely transformed Indian trade with cotton, jute, tea, and coal dominating the domain. The time was ripe for expansion, from unit banking to branch banking, to go to interiors, take banking services to wider range of people. Branches were opened in Rangoon, Dhaka, Patna, Mirzapur, Banaras, Pune, Ahmedabad, Karachi, Calicut, Bangalore, and many other places by the three banks. Gradually, some other banks also came on the scene. Allahabad Bank in 1865, Punjab National Bank in 1895, Indian Bank in 1907, and Central Bank of India in 1911. Year 1876. The three banks were brought under one statute to make them presidency banks to represent the three presidencies in the financial market. The year 1921. A year of an imperial decision. The year of the second incarnation of the bank. The three presidency banks of Bengal, Bombay and Madras were merged to form Imperial Bank of India. Gradually thereafter, the process of Indianization of the bank started with recruitment of Indians as probationary officers. But the discrimination about wages and increments on the basis of colour continued, leading Sir Dinshaw Adelji Wacha and J.R.D. Tata, a director on the board, to take up the cudgels on behalf of the Indians and rock the boat. Very eminent Indian personalities adorned the board of the bank. Sir Annamalai Chettiar, J.R.D. Tata, Sir Jamshedji Jiji Boy, Sir Dinshar Manakji Petit, Maharaja Sukumar Roy, and other elites. India earned independence on the 15th of August 1947. By this time, the Imperial Bank was already dominating the market with a market share of 30% of deposits and 23% of advances. 1st July 1955, a red letter day for the banking industry in India. By an Act of Parliament, Imperial Bank was reconstituted to form the State Bank of India. Dr. John Mathai, former finance minister, was the first chairman of SBI. Mr. V.L. Mehta, the vice chairman, Mr. S.K. Handu and Mr. B.P. Patel, the first managing directors of the bank. The colourful journey of State Bank thereafter has been through the industry, small and medium industries, agriculture, through the lives of common people, the downtrodden, and massive and deliberate financial inclusion. In the process, along with an emerging economy of the world, the State Bank of India has become the largest bank of India. With the state-of-the-art IT initiative, massive network of branches, unfathomable reach to the community, SBI today is all set to take on global challenges. Hold its head high amidst the ruins all around, and continue to march forward and take the Indian banking industry and the economy to greater heights. A unique setup, the State Bank archives portray in a fascinating manner the history of India's premier commercial bank over two centuries, in which the bank not only initiated people, trade and industry to modern banking, but also played a pivotal role in shaping the country's economy. Today, the bank continues its pioneering forays into diverse areas of banking, converting challenges into opportunities. In no other financial archives would perhaps one see such a rich display of original documents and articles of great historical importance. In these archives, there is a wooden box which held part of Mahatma Gandhi's ashes for nearly half a century, till they were immersed in the Holy Sangam. The State Bank archives not only retrieves part of the common national heritage, but also ensures preservation of the bank's archival material. The archives will also enable research scholars in redefining the legacy of the bank and of the Indian people as the ultimate beneficiaries and controllers of that legacy.
Years come rarely in the life of an institution. Most wither away, but a few who remain make their mark. State Bank of India, my bank, is one such institution. It was therefore for me a matter of great pride when in May 2007, I inaugurated the State Bank Archives in Kolkata, the first financial archives and museum of a commercial bank in India, and a showpiece for the entire Indian banking industry. These archives are dedicated to each and every one of our employees and each and every one of our customers, both past and present, who have actually made this glorious institution what it is today. I urge all of you to go and visit the archives at the earliest opportunity, and I guarantee that you will return enthralled.